2016何鴻燊博士醫療拓展基金會醫學研討會第三部分現在正式開始，有請實踐大學董事長謝萬雄教授以及澳門科技大學健康科學學院副院長林偉基教授為我們主持，有請兩位。
而第三部分研討會嘅主講嘉賓分別有烏陽正醫生、趙孝明教授以及係張如斌教授，將時間交俾兩位主持人，唔該曬。好，尊敬嘅圈主席、沈校長、許教授、胡教授，各位親切嘅同事，早晨，感謝同埋歡迎大家喺呢個咁寒冷嘅早上嚟臨參加2016年洪新博士醫療拓展基金會同埋香港中文大學。 聯合主辦嘅醫學研討會嘅第二日嘅議程，今日嘅議程第一個環節，我哋好幸運請到三位嚟自台灣同埋香港卓越嘅專家學者為我哋做講座。咁講者嘅次序有少少調整，咁俾我介紹咧，係第一位講者咧係烏陽正教授。 邬教授係香港中文大學威斯森王醫院內科顧問醫生同埋心臟內科 cardiologist， 佢早年喺英國倫敦大學醫科畢業咗之後，先後喺倫敦大學、加拿大嘅英屬哥倫比亞大學同埋美國嘅哈佛大學接受心臟內科嘅訓練同埋工作。 佢今日係同我哋講嘅題目係 interventional cardiology， 邬教授請。
Thank you for the kind introduction. I'm delighted to be here to be able to share with you the great developments in interventional cardiology in the past few years. This has been a field that's really changed dramatically. So I'm going to talk about really the big changes in interventional cardiology. The absorbable scaffold, which is now beginning to replace stenting. The transcatheter aortic valve replacement, or TAVI. The left atrial appendage occlusion, LAAO. The mitral clip. And also the change in one of the hardest frontier in interventional cardiology, CTO intervention, how to do CTO intervention by algorithms now. So, why, first of all, the absorbable scaffold. Why are we talking about absorbable scaffold? If we put a stent, a metallic stent, into a patient, every year there's a 0.3% risk of the stent occluding suddenly. And obviously, if you have a stent inside, if you need surgery or you need to stop your aspirin in future, there's a risk of stent thrombosis. Stents, if you put into a vessel, after a long period of time, the stress might cause the stent to fracture. Also, if you have a re-narrowing inside the stent, what we call restenosis, putting another layer is not a good solution because increasing number of layers of stent increase the risk of fracture. Coronary disease is occurring in younger patients, and also the disease is getting worse. Many of my patients nowadays, they require 5, 6, or even 7 stents to treat the disease. So you're beginning to put longer and longer stents with the consequences of stent thrombosis. So about 4 years ago, the manufacturer of a scaffold, a polymer-based absorbable scaffold, replacing a stent, has been developed by Abbott Vascular. This is called a BVS. This scaffold is absorbed after it stays in the vessel for about 3 years, and it leaves behind no trace of the stent. It's less deliverable than traditional metallic stent, and it's less robust, but it has the same efficacy in terms of restenosis and outcome. So this is the demonstration. You see at the top, the scaffold implanted right afterwards, and these little squares that you see begin to dissolve at 6 months, and by 2 years you can see the vessel is like new. So in our practice nowadays, if you are under 70 years old, we consider using this kind of BVS. If you need 2 stents, BVS is very good, because at the carina, the new division, if you absorb all the stents, you can have a new vessel altogether. Patients who need surgery in the near future, this is a group that should have BVS. If you have a metallic stent that has restenosis, that's another indication for considering BVS. Obviously, because BVS is less deliverable, we still use it in easier lesions. This is the next generation. Now, this is not yet available. This is a magnesium absorbable stent developed by Biotronic, and this absorbs even faster than BVS. Within 12 months, it's disappeared. It's metallic, so it's better in terms of deliverance, and it's also stronger in radial strength. So it functions pretty much like our metallic stents. So this stent has a similar late loss to all the stents we see nowadays in the market. And the stent is called Dreams, and it's 12 months reabsorption. It's got better performance and almost equivalent delivery ability to drug stents. So this will be available this year, at the end of this year. Scaffold, I'm not sure, is not going to answer all the questions and all the problems of interventional coronary work. But I think scaffolds will dominate the market. It will gradually replace stents. There'll be many companies that will develop many scaffolds, and you'll have a great choice of scaffolds to treat your patients with. And gradually, it will be increasingly used in more and more complicated subgroups of diseases, including total occlusion. So moving quickly on, the next topic I want to talk about is TAVI. TAVI is a transcatheter, minimally invasive implantation of an aortic valve for aortic stenosis. And this is a range of the TAVI valves. Severe aortic stenosis is a very common condition, but it occurs mostly in the elderly. And many of the patients are too old, too frail, or too high surgical risk. In Asia, in this area, many patients don't like to have a big scar. They don't like to have open heart surgery. And so it's particularly relevant to the Asia-Pacific area. These patients, they do badly when they are treated just with medicines. And they also don't do well with high-risk surgery. So a minimally invasive aortic valve replacement is a very good solution. And now there's been a lot of data supporting the use of this. TAVI versus medical therapy. If you don't do surgery versus doing a transcatheter implantation, this is the difference. In 24 months, you gain a 20% absolute mortality benefit. One in five patients less die after 24 months. This is a huge mortality benefit in terms of clinical trial. TAVI versus surgical AVR for very high-risk patients. And you see equivalent. This is a 60-month data from the partner trial, the original trial. And you see, for very high-risk surgery, if you do a percutaneous valve, you do just as well 60 months later. This is the core valve pivotal trial. So this is a newer valve. Again, comparing high-risk surgery against the TAVI, and you actually have a benefit. You have a 6% absolute benefit in terms of all-cause mortality within 24 months. So the newer valves actually are even better than the original Edwards valve. So in summary, superior treatment when compared to medical therapy in patients who are not operable. Superior treatment when compared to surgical AVR in patients who are at high risk. Superior treatment option compared to surgical AVR in extreme risk patients. It's a superior treatment, probably, in all categories. The cost, unfortunately, is $260,000, so it's very expensive treatment. But as more valves develop, this cost will come down. So now we have a very good treatment for aortic stenosis. Next is LAAO. This is left atrial appendage occlusion. As you know, one of the problems is atrial fibrillation. Increasingly, as our patient population is getting older, atrial fibrillation is becoming more prevalent. Traditionally, we use warfarin to treat atrial fibrillation to prevent strokes. Nowadays, we have new oral anticoagulants, NOAC. But many patients still cannot tolerate NOAC or warfarin due to bleeding. It may be something very benign, like having hemorrhoids or diverticulosis, that will stop you being treated. These patients are a good candidate for LAAO. Most of the clots from atrial fibrillation come from the left atrial appendage. If you put an umbrella to block the left atrial appendage, you actually prevent stroke. This is the pivotal trial, the Watchman clinical trial called PROTECT AF, you see the second trial here, which compared the warfarin compared to LAAO occlusion, in terms of CV death, in terms of stroke, in terms of all-cause mortality. And you can see in terms of WATCHMAN, there's continuing registries and trials to demonstrate its efficacy. This is the PROTECT AF data, and you see the primary efficacy, CV death, and all-cause stroke is all lower compared to warfarin. Warfarin is not a good treatment for stroke. So LAO, again, superior treatment options compared to warfarin. It's a non-inferior treatment for stroke prevention, but it's superior for disabling and major strokes. It's superior to warfarin in terms of quality of life, and it's superior for cardiovascular death. So it's a superior treatment for most cases if you compare to warfarin. How does it compare to NOAC? Well, we don't have the answer yet. So LAO is now becoming, again, one of these treatments that's available for patients who cannot take traditional therapy. The people who fall outside what medicine can treat currently can now be treated. Finally, another device in this category is the MitraClip. The MitraClip is a clip that can be delivered percutaneously in a minimal invasive manner to clip the mitral valve to reduce mitral regurgitation. It's for patients with severe mitral regurgitations who are too high risk for operation. The aim is to improve the quality of life because most of these people have very bad left ventricles and they are not going to live very long. And so far, it's been done mostly from registry data. And the European registries have been as large as almost 1,000 patients, and they demonstrate very effective reduction in mitral regurgitation and very efficient improvement in the patient's quality of life. Patients go from a bed-bound patient with heart failure to somebody who can walk around at home, on the ward, and even outdoors. And it has a very low 30-day and one-year mortality and good complication rates. So the MitraClip is a very effective therapy for heart failure class 4 patients who are too high risk for surgery, who have severe mitral regurgitation. And this again treats one group who are outside the borders of current medical therapy. Finally, CTO. As we know, about 5-6 years ago, this hybrid algorithm written by the Americans have dominated the CTO market. And this algorithm approach, a way of saying how you should do each case, running down an algorithm, has been shown to be very effective. But there are some things that are not so good about the hybrid algorithm, mainly because the cross-pulse and stimulant device, which it depends on, is very expensive, and the techniques are not widely available. So we formed a CTO club, which is I'm one of the directors, and you can see the group here, from all over Asia-Pacific region. And from this club, we developed an algorithm to treat a new algorithm to treat CTO. And I think algorithm treatment of CTO is really the new frontier of treating this difficult barrier in interventional cardiology. You can read more about it in our website, APCTO Club. So we have also a retrograde algorithm and an IVUS algorithm, but I'm not going to show you the details of this. The main difference is uses the strength available in Asia, which is IVUS, new generation wires, parallel wire. It also has the American influence, the cross-pulse stimulator. And it's all about using knowledge to overcome difficulties. And it's a highly knowledge-based algorithm. And it incorporates proctoring, hands-on teaching, improved success rate, and obviously we're doing a registry to prove the efficacy of this algorithm. So the future of intervention. I think the future looks very bright. A lot of off-the-radar, forgotten cases now, like patients very old with aortic stenosis, like patients with very bad heart failure with mitral regurgitations, can now all be treated. More and more valvular disease can be treated in this way. There's now percutaneous mitral valve replacement. Adsorbable stents would dominate the market, and you'd be able to treat far more disease, leaving behind very little metal. And the knowledge-based driven algorithm to treat CTO will break through this barrier in interventional cardiology. So I recommend this bright future to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Wu Professor, just now, about integrative cardiac surgery, the latest development, very simple, but very interesting talk. We have some time, please, everyone. Wu Professor,
我唔知問嗰啲咩都推唔切，咁頭先你講嘅elderness，即係老人出城，我唔知係咩嚟㗎，當然唔詳細㗎。譬如話，嗰啲人過咗80歲，好多條頸啊，咁即係嗰啲人就話個心反咧，嗰個血咧麻麻地，嗰個心臟，成日都散下散下，突然間一擠，就擠咗塊咧，塊咧上咗個腦度，嗰個腦度咁就中風啦。咁頭先你講個elderness就係講呢個度，呢個程度啊嘛，咁我可唔可以望喺度，即係好似個天羅地網咁啊，就stop呢啲咁嘅血塊咧，去到個腦度。嗯，係。咁我咪嗰個中風嘅機會咪希望減低咯咁樣。係，咁其實咧兩樣。
其實咧兩樣都有㗎，咁呢個心耳封堵咧就係整個網阻住佢開始有嗰啲血塊嘅，係啦。咁但係咧而家咧亦有一個網咧係擺喺佢腦嗰啲血管嗰度，咁我哋做呢個 TAVI 嘅時候咧會擺個網咧嚟防止啲血塊上去個腦嗰度，亦有嘅。咁所以其實你諗嗰兩個方法咧都而家有做緊嘅，咁亦係一個好有效嘅方法嚟嘅。
我應該幾時做啱咧？有個 check
四啦。啊，其實咧就我諗第一步咧就係你有冇 AF， 因為如果你有 AF 有心律不穩咧，咁你中風嘅機會會高啊。咁所以第一樣嘢咧就要 check 有冇 AF。咁而家有個好叻嘅，我個 iPhone 嗰度咧，佢後面咧有塊嘢咧可以貼喺嗰個蓋嗰度咧，你撳隻手指入去就睇到有冇 AF 嘅喎。 好抵嘅就好似$200到嘅啫，係啊，可以買嘅 download 嘅 app， 我諗啊，胡教授都知道啲點樣整嘅呢個。好，沈校長。
Thank you for introducing all this new technology in interventional cardiology. But whenever there is a new device, there is a paradigm shift, and all the indications might also change. For example, in the past. You only put in a stent when the artery is 90% occluded. But now with this scaphoid, bioabsorbable, it is so safe and it makes a perfect artery diameter. Will you then change the indication? You do it much earlier and so on? This is my first question. So how much would the usual guidelines need to be revisit and revise? And my second question is, when new technology is being introduced, it's always very exciting, but sometimes we may not be able to see the long-term effect. I know some of your slides showed 2 years, you have improvement in mortality 20%, but what about 5 years, what about 7 years? Would there be complications arising at the later stage that we have not been able to predict? Because the time is still short.
Mm. Thank you for those two very good questions. In fact, the first question, which is to whether it's worth now doing lesions that are maybe less stenotic or maybe acute lesions, plaque rupture. So there is a big randomized controlled trial being conducted by SJ Park in Korea called the definitive trial to answer this problem. So it's a randomized trial in patients who came in with acute coronary syndrome to do an OCT to see how narrow it is, whether there's plaque rupture. And then, in the lesion that's not significant, they randomize to either putting in a scaffold or not putting in anything. And this is going to be followed up for 5 years, so to see a five-year outcome. So this trial will give us the data probably by the 2019-2020, we'll have the five-year data. The one-year data will come out, but the power calculation suggests 1 year is not going to make a difference, because an acute lesion that you put a scaffold in is going to take longer to see the difference. So probably
so the
we'll have
line has not been changed.
No. So we're waiting for the randomized control trial. So another 5 or 6 years time, if this randomized control trial is positive, then I think it will push towards the guidelines being changed. So that's the first. The second question was
long-term
data. So we have all these randomized trials have been done, and they keep collecting data for 5 years, 10 years. But the part of the problem is the technology is developing too quickly. The next generation of valves is already out, and the next generation, when they do their initial data, is also better than last generation. So So by the time your 10-year data comes out, your 2-year data of a new valve is better, and so people keep using the new technology. There's also the registry which helps us. So the registry has picked up some issues with TAVI, that there is valve thrombosis. But there's also valve thrombosis with mechanical valves. So, you know, we picked up things that we didn't see in the randomized controlled trial, but it's not at a very high rate that causes us to worry. So we always worry about a new device that you start putting into a lot of patients and then a lot of problems come. So that's why now TAVI is still limited, really, to patients who are either very ill or very old, so that the long-term outcome we're not so worried about. But I think there, when we have the 10-20-year data, if it looks very good, we'll start putting it into much younger patients.
In other words, although this new technology looks very exciting, we should not jump into it too quickly. We should still take a cautious approach and wait for more data until the guideline is modified. Am I correct?
Yes, I think for something like a scaffold, you must wait for the guideline to change. You shouldn't jump into it and put into it without evidence. For something like TAVI, there's already very good evidence for short-term outcome. So I think you can jump into it for patients who are going to be short-term. You know, you're a 96-year-old, or recently we had a 100-year-old with severe AS, you should jump into it, because 2 years, they have a better outcome, and they're not likely to live beyond 102. So, but for the younger patients, you should be cautious, especially the under 70 group.
You be careful, there are many people living beyond 102.
Yes.
好,我們還有時間可以問多個問題,看看後面這題,許教授。我用廣東話問,聽聽一下,觀眾都可以明白。你那些micro clip,即是repair,micro腳減低的micro腳,因為心臟泵的時候,那個壓力都很大,它如果有多持久,會不會脫掉或者怎樣?其實這個micro
clip 其實現在因為它揭了之後,心臟裡面的細胞就會生上去,所以它揭得很小,所以脫就極少有,都是 case report 都是一兩單是脫了,但固然之後過10年20年後怎樣呢?不知道,因為這班的病人都是很差的 left ventricular function 只有10-20%, 這些病人多數都不會survive到5-10年,所以其實現在就算我們做了6-7年,
都沒有病人是survive到6-7年,所以全部都是一個很短期的答案。好,如果大家不介意,我們準時完成,接下來呢,我想,好,OK,後面是不是有沒有?有沒有?啊,這個,不是,正話是沒有,沒有,接下來呢,我就帶